Allahu Akbar.
Assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Innal hamdalillah nahmaduhu wa nasta'inuhu wa nastaghfiruh wa na'udhu billahi min shururi anfusina wa min sayyiati a'malina. Man yahdihillahu fala mudilla lahu wa man yudlil fala hadiya lahu. Wa ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wahdahu la sharika lahu wa ashhadu anna Muhammadan 'abduhu wa rasuluhu. Sallallahu ala alihi wa ashabihi wa man tabi'ahum bi ihsanin ila yawmiddin amma ba'd. Rabbi shah li sadri wa ihdil li amri wa ihlil uqdatan min lisani yafqahu qawli. Allahumma arina al-haqqa haqqan wa ruzuqna tiba'ah wa arina al-batila batilan wa ruzuqna shinaba. Amin ya rabbil alameen. So welcome to the ICNA Dawah conference. ICNA is the conference title is Islam, the solution in times of confusion. Our next speaker is none other than one of my favorites. Alhamdulillah, I've known this brother for a while. He's one of my, he's a researcher at Sapien Institute. He's the lead instructor for Ayah, and he's the coolest guy that I know. Without further ado, inshallah, I give you Fahad Tasleem.
Jazakallah khair. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alameen. Wassalatu wassalam ala Rasulil Kareem amma ba'd. So I was just told I need to kind of shorten what I wanted to say, which was already shortened. So before I get into what we're going to be speaking about today, which is ayah-based thinking or sign-based thinking, I just wanted to mention that being part of Sapien Institute, if you're not familiar with it, we're kind of the research, in a sense, the research wing of Ayah. And so a lot of the items that I'm going to be speaking about, in addition to some of the other speakers that you may have heard, Ustaz Hamza, Zortzis, etc., a lot of our research is on the Sapien Institute website. So today, what I'm speaking about, there's actually an extended session, and it's called Beauty and the Recognition of God. So if you'd like more information on what I'm going to speak about in more detail, you can check out that webinar, inshallah, and I think it is online and recorded. So with that said, let me start in earnest. And the background behind this topic basically starts with the idea that we live in what we call a post-truth world. And what I mean by that is that when we are online, and we're a lot more online than we were ever before, as was just mentioned, we find that we have this phenomena of information overload. And one of the things is that when you have information overload, you start to see the idea of the truth being relative or bendable, all right? So if you're coming if we make it as a political division between the right and the left, a conservative versus a liberal stance on how you view the world, then you're going to be in a position where how do you judge something to be true from just the sheer amount of information? Because as human beings, we form what's known as heuristics or shortcuts when we're trying to establish things to be true or false, when we're trying to establish facts, okay? But in the online environment, with all of the information that we have, these shortcuts are sometimes, we may directly feel that they're failing us. So on the right side of the spectrum, on the conservative side, the idea that you can't trust the scientific community. Now, this sort of a breakdown has serious implications on things like dealing with the COVID-19 issue, the COVID-19 virus. Similarly, on the left, you have certain elements of, let's say, not trusting religious scholarship or religious institutions, etc. You have other elements within the left that breaks down the idea of how do you know what is true, right? So one way in which you get information is from the testimony of other people. Like, when it comes to science, you don't know all the science. You read the research papers, and then you form conclusions. When you're going to form certain theological conclusions, you're going to do that via the testimony of somebody else. Once that breaks down, now what do you do? So when you move from trusting somebody else, if you can't do that, now you're going to move to trusting yourself. But even when it comes to trusting yourself, there's certain information that you can rationally come to, but sometimes you are wrong. And so that's what kind of, that's where I wanted to head into this very topic, is what, is there any other tool you can use besides getting information from somebody else, or even trying to trust your own senses and your own limited worldview? And one of the things that I'm proposing, and by the way, it's not something new, right? It is a way of thinking that moves from what we call discursive reasoning, right? Where we reason things out by way of, like deductive reasoning and things like that, to move to more of an ayah-based thinking, okay? And this is something that's prevalent within the Quran itself, all right? The idea of ayahs, the idea of signs. So one of the things that I'm sure most of the people listening know is that the Quran, the individual, what you may call verses, as sometimes is translated, they're actually called ayat in the Quran, right? The ayat of the Quran, the what they translate as verses, but an ayah is a sign. Now, it would not be hyperbolous, it would not be an exaggeration to say that every single thing in your life is a sign. Every single thing in your life is a sign. In fact, you could say that the very phenomenon of signification, you know, having something to mean something else, have something to be pointing towards something else, is what basically underlines all of human existence. Now, you may think, wait, that may be somewhat of an exaggeration. But when you think about what is the purpose of a sign is something that is basically filling in the gap to mean something else, okay? And it is fundamental to how you view the entire world, all right? Now, I'll just give you some practical things that just to highlight the importance of signs. When you're driving down the road and you see the golden arches, now you have that, you may not even read the sign underneath it that says McDonald's, but immediately you recognize that, okay, that is a restaurant. Now, what's really fascinating is that depending on your background, you may have a different reaction to that sign, right? So for instance, if you grew up and in the States and when you were little, your parents took you to McDonald's, and as soon as you see those golden arches, you remember, you know, the cheeseburger, or, well, if you're in a Desi household, probably a fish fillet, whatever, right? You remember the time your parents took you to the McDonald's, and you would sit there and everyone would come together. And so when you see the golden arches, it leads to a feeling of, wow, that's, I really remember that time. It was amazing. Now, if you're looking at it from a different perspective, maybe you just got done seeing a documentary like Super Size Me, where the individual goes and he eats McDonald's for a full month, and then his cholesterol goes through the roof, and it's just like this experiment that he does. And you, from that perspective, when you see the golden arches, you see, ah, this is one of those, you know, that's a danger sign. Like, you don't want to eat that food. It's a corporate giant. It has all of these evils, whatever it might be. So that is just something as simple as the golden arches, and you see two very different reactions. The reality is that that particular sign is pointing you towards a certain reality that you yourself experience. Okay. Now, that's just a sign that is a man-made sign. Okay. Now, the issue with man-made signs, so we're talking about a sign like the golden arches, or we're talking about a sign like a painting in a frame. When you see it, you appreciate it. And so it may elicit certain feelings because you see, okay, well, that painting is beautiful, or whatever it might be, or a certain type of architecture that you might find beautiful, right? But here's the thing. When it comes to man-made signs, the reality is that when you're looking at something made by a human being, you have to have a certain level of caution. And basically, the idea is that you need to be aware of the boundaries and risks, because you understand that a person is behind, let's say, the particular sign that you're looking at, okay? Whether that's a painting, or whether that's even text, by the way. And one of the things that I'll mention really quickly, remember I said that signs basically are like everything can be a potential sign. And I wasn't exaggerating, because even when you think about the phenomena of language, you and I work with symbols and signs. Whether those symbols and signs are sound, that we're now expressing. So we have a certain meaning and we have a certain sound that's attached to it, and that's how you're able to understand what I'm saying. Or we're looking at orthography, which is the written script. So an A symbolizes a certain sound, which when comes together with other symbols, signifies a certain meaning. And so therefore, language itself is sign-based. You learn everything that you know, pretty much everything that you know, by way of signs. However, what happens when you're looking at signs that are man-made, you understand that there are limitations because the human being is limited. And this is not an issue of being Muslim or non-Muslim. This is something that you understand that an artist makes a certain sign, makes a certain painting, that there are limitations. They're framing it. They're looking at it from a certain perspective, right? You have an author, like I have this random book here, Sapiens, right? You understand that this is written by a certain author. Now, based on your idea of who the author is, you're going to approach this very text, right? So if you know Yuval Harari, you know that he's an atheist, he's Israeli, he's homosexual, he's a vegan. I mean, there's so much background information that will give you the lenses, a certain type of lenses, when you approach the text itself. So all of that is what we call the idea is that human beings, when the signs are coming from a human being, they're going to have a certain bias. And everybody understands this. And so in order to, what are the signs that have no bias? That's where I'm trying to move to. And this is something that's kind of accepted by humans. The signs and the objects that have no bias is those signs that are in nature, because they're not coming from a human project. Whether you're an atheist, whether you're a Christian, a Jew, a Hindu, a Muslim, you understand nature has a certain purity to it. It's unbiased. And that's why a lot of marketers understand this and try to sell us products that are natural, because natural is good. With human beings, you have to be aware of boundaries, limitations, but nature is good. Nature is unbiased. And so when we move to the Quran, you find one of the things that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala points us towards is in fact signs in nature. Because why? Because from a human standpoint, they are unbiased. They're not the work of a human being. And so when it comes to this idea, when you're judging a sign, when you're judging something in nature, the idea is there's nothing behind it. There's no bias. Okay? Now that's basically based on natural signs. And that's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, for instance, says, Inna fi khalqi samawati wal ard wa ikhtilafi wal layli wa nahar, in the creation of the heavens and the earth and the alteration of the night and the day are indeed signs, right? Liulil albab, for people who think. Why is Allah pointing us towards signs within nature? Is because that is the equalizer in a certain sense. There's no bias behind it. But even when it comes to the Quran, and I'll share one particular ayah that I'm speaking about. When it comes to the Quran, what's very fascinating about it is that it is a written text. Now I want us to think real quick about certain types of writing that we consider beautiful. Right? Because signs and beauty actually have a relationship with each other. So if that's the case, when you think about a piece of poetry that's moved you, right? Like if you are a fan of Muhammad Iqbal, Al-Am Iqbal, rahimahullah, you read certain poetry, it elicits a certain feeling. Now that poetry is different from straight prose. Okay? Prose is something that just gives you information. So prose is something like your chemistry textbook. All right? You have a chemistry textbook and then you have poetry. What are some of the differences? With poetry, you're going to want to now sit and think about it. Inquire, what did the author mean by this? When he put these words together, why did he put them together in this way? And it elicits a certain feeling within inside of you. And so you can read the poem over and over again. Sometimes you could approach a poem at the age of, let's say, 20, and then at 30 you read it again, and then later on it changes. With a chemistry textbook, it's just flat, right? You read it once and you'll never approach it again. So there's something between prose and poetry that distinguishes both of them. And similarly, when it comes to the Quran, we know from our scholars that it's not prose and it's not poetry. It's something in between. It's something completely separate, right? If that's the case when it comes to human poetry, how much more so when it comes to the ayat that are within the Quran itself? So this way of thinking is actually one that the Quran encourages and asks us to shift to. And I'll leave you with this one quote. It's by Angelica Newworth, and she's a kind of a Western scholar of the Quran. And she says, in terms of this idea of the Quran being filled with signs and the impact that it has, she says, it is in the end the pagan's verdict from Surat al-Qamar, the verdict of his Sihr al-Bayan, his transformation of the world into a sign system, transcending empirical reality, that is allowed to epitomize the Quran's hermeneutical achievement. In other words, the thinking that is, it's not only that the Quran is bringing a new message, it's bringing a new way of viewing the world that we live in. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best. And I'll go ahead and stop there because I know Azad's giving me the stink eye. So,
yeah. Thank you, barakallahu lakum. Thank you so much, Fahad. Zakallahu khair, barakallahu. And with all the signs that are happening, and people wanted to make sure that they don't want to even want the extra hour in 2020 when the time is going to roll back. They're like, you know. But anyway, with all of the signs and all of these indications that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has granted us, how do you, as a Muslim in the West, how do you interpret those signs in a positive, you know, in a way that it was meant for us to learn a lesson from it?
So are we referring, do you mean like natural signs, or do you mean like
all the signs, you know, from the coronaviruses and all the earthquakes, sure, and fires and all these signs that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has been, you know?
So, I mean, look, I mean, one of the purposes of a sign is to point you to something else, right? Is to have you reflect upon some sort of kind of deeper truth that's within inside of us. And as we know, theologically, that, you know, that we, every single child is born upon the fitrah. So every human has a fitrah. So one of the functions of ayat is to actually either like awaken the fitrah or reawaken the fitrah, right? So those are, that's kind of one of the, you know, one of the ways in which we interpret the signs that we see around us, right? Now, what if you take the coronavirus as a sign or whatever it might be, that's kind of the main idea behind it, is to get us to think about deeper existential questions related to our existence. Like, why am I here? Where am I going? What happens when I die? Even as, alhamdulillah, you know, Muslims, we know the answers. So we have, yani, what's known as ilm al-yaqeen. Like, we're certain about the answers, but sometimes we need the signs to refresh those realities that we understand intellectually to make them a reality in the heart, right? And so therefore, that, you know, it's interpreting that to bring you back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I mean, one of the things that I'll just mention really quick, one of the results of COVID is that we have become a lot more, we're spending a lot more time indoors. And I think that this has certain spiritual implications on us, right? So it's important for us to take some time, even if you can just walk out of your house and look up at the sky and just reflect, right? Because that detachment from the natural world actually does have an impact on us, right? I'll tell you just some internal research within Aira. We find that, and again, this is not conclusive, but the rate at which people take shahada within the developing world, or what's known as the developing world, is exponentially higher than it is in the Western world, right? Yeah. Even though Dawah efforts are going on, one of those reasons is that people in the quote-unquote developing world are connected to nature and are reflecting upon that a lot more than people who are more insular, internal, with their faces in front of screens, which again are framed. Even if you're watching a YouTube video about a mountain that's beautiful, it's still within a frame. It's not the actual mountain, which has a limitlessness, which puts you in a state of awe.
Exactly. Okay. Thank you. And last question, DC or Marvel?
Marvel, come on. Okay. So you can't tell that from the...
I know. we have to get it. Zakallah khair. Thank you so much. And barakallahu lakum. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.